Welcome to Curious Vet channel. I am Dr. Mohsina. The topic for today's video is an important topic. It's the Bracken fund poisoning. So before going to the details of poisoning, let's see some points regarding this plant. Bracken fern, the scientific name is Pteridium aquilinum. So this is the picture of bracken fern plant. I'm sure that you might have seen this before. And this plant is found throughout the world. It's a perennial with erect deciduous fronds that remain green until they are killed by frost or drought. Bracken fern is found in a diversity of sites, but most commonly seen in semi-shaded, well-drained and open woodlands. Coming to the syndromes caused by the poisoning. A variety of syndromes have been associated with bracken fern poisoning. These syndromes are largely determined by some factors, that is the dose, duration, and the species of the poisoned animal. Now let's see one by one. First one is enzootic hematuria. It is very important in cattle. So enzootic hematuria is the most common result of bracken fern poisoning. It primarily affects cattle and less frequently affects sheep. It is characterized by intermittent hematuria and anemia. In this picture you can see a cattle with hematuria. The discoloration of urine is clearly seen. Poisoning most often occurs during late summer because at that time other feed is scarce, or when animals are fed hay containing bracken fern as well. Then poisoning requires prolonged exposures. Affected livestock must ingest bracken fern for several weeks to years for the disease to develop. Coming to the clinical signs of enzootic hematuria. Affected cattle are weak, they rapidly lose weight and develop pyrexia of 106 to 110 degree Fahrenheit. The clinical signs in calves, they often have difficulty in breathing and pale mucous membranes. In these pictures, you can see petechial hemorrhage and pallor in mucous membranes. Hemorrhages vary from minor mucosal petechiae to effusive bleeding. Large blood clots form and that may be passed in the feces. Coagulation is prolonged and bleeding may be pronounced and excessive even at small wounds such as small insect bites or minor scratches. Lesions. Once animal developed the clinical disease, poisoning is almost always fatal and postmortem examination usually reveals multiple hemorrhages or bruises throughout the carcass, and necrotic ulcers in the GI tract may also be noted. In this picture you can see the hemorrhages in the intestine. So these are the pictures of some of the lesions. The first one is showing hemorrhage over the serosal surface of omasum. Second one is hemorrhage in intestine. And third one shows hemorrhage in the myocardium. Bladder mucosa often contains small hemorrhages, dilated vessels, and also vascular, fibrous or epithelial neoplasms. Other neoplasms in the upper GI tract of cattle and other species have also been reported. In most cases, mixtures of hemorrhagic and neoplastic lesions are found. The primary cause of ensutic hematuria have been attributed to norsesquiterpene glycosides, that is tacylocyte, desculentocyte and cordatocyte. Tacylocyte is a potent radiomimetic that initially damages the bone marrow and later it is carcinogenic. So this is the toxin. This is the carcinogenic, that is tacylocyte, causing the urinary bladder neoplasia. And coming to the next disease, that is the acute brackenism or hemorrhagic disease caused by bracken fund poisoning. Acute brackenism occurs when animals ingest high doses over relatively short duration of weeks or months. It is characterized by bleeding and attributed to the tacylocyte's radiomimetic damage to proliferating bone marrow stem cells. Depletion of bone marrow megakaryocytes are seen in this condition. The leukogram often shows a mixed response. In the initial phases, monocyte may be pronounced, followed by granulocytopenia and thrombocytopenia. So, in contrast to ensutic hematuria, this condition is caused by high dose of toxin over a short duration of time. And the final phases include marked thrombocytopenia, anemia, leukopenia and hypergamma globulinemia. Urinalysis generally shows hematuria and proteinuria, increased susceptibility to infection and tendency for spontaneous hemorrhage. Lower doses of bracken fund for longer duration are more likely to be carcinogenic. The effects seem cumulative as animals are exposed repeatedly for years. Often, the onset of clinical disease can be delayed for weeks or even months after animals have been removed from bracken fund infested ranges and pastures. So these pictures show some squamous cell carcinomas in the upper GI tract caused by chronic bracken fund poisoning. The top left one shows squamous cell carcinoma in the base of tongue, and the top right one shows in the condition in pharynx. The bottom left one is squamous cell carcinoma in the distal esophagus, and the bottom right one shows the condition of rumen with squamous cell carcinoma. Now, the carcinogenic potential of bracken fund and tacylocyte has been confirmed not only in livestock but also in rats, mice, guinea pigs, quail and also in Egyptian toads. Tacylocyte is excreted in urine and milk. Small amounts have also been identified in skeletal muscle and liver of poisoned animals even after a 15-day withdrawal period. Contaminated milk retains toxicity. It has been shown to produce GI neoplasms in rats as well. Tachylocyte neoplastic transformation may be promoted or enhanced by bovine papilloma virus infection. Secondary change due to BRCA1-associated myelodysplasia and subsequent immunosuppression will promote the papilloma virus infection. So in these pictures, you can see the papillomas associated with chronic poisoning in cattle. There is multiple oropharyngeal papillomas in the first picture. Then coming to the next condition, that is the bright blindness. It is a less common manifestation of tachylocyte toxicity. It is clinically seen as tapetal hyperreflectivity, and most commonly reported in sheep in part of England and Wales. Affected sheep are permanently blind. They adopt a characteristic alert attitude, and the pupils respond poorly to light. Ophthalmoscopic examination of sheep with advanced disease reveals narrowing of arteries and veins and a pale tapetum nigrum with fine cracks and spots of grey. Histologically, there is severe atrophy of retinal rods, cones, outer nuclear layer, and that is most pronounced in the tapetal portion of the retina. Affected animals often have many of other BRCA1-associated lesions such as bone marrow suppression, hemorrhage, immunosuppression, and urinary tract neoplasia as well. Coming to the next condition, it is the Brachystegus. It is mostly reported in horses. BRCA1 poisoning in monogastric animals was first recognized as a neurologic disease when horses consumed the contaminated hay. Ingestion at a rate of 20-25% of BRCA1 for more than 3 months may result in Brachystegus. Clinical signs in horses are anorexia, weight loss, incoordination, and crouching stance while arching the back and neck with feet placed wide apart. When the horse is forced to move, trembling muscles are noted. In severe cases, tachycardia and arrhythmias are present. Death, usually 2 to 10 days after onset of clinical signs, is preceded by convulsions, clonic spasm, and opisthotonus. These changes are due to BRCA1 thiaminases. The resulting disease is similar to vitamin B1 deficiency, and most animals, that is thiamine deficiency, most animals respond to thiamine therapy. So this disease is similar to polioencephalomalacia caused by thiamine deficiency in ruminants. Let's see this condition in pigs. In pigs, this disease is rare, but we have seen that horses are mostly susceptible. And in pigs, the signs of thiamine deficiency are less distinct and may resemble heart failure. Affected pigs become anorectic and lose weight. Death can occur suddenly after recumbency and dyspnea. In ruminants, thiamine deficiency is generally not a problem in ruminants because the vitamin is synthesized in rumen. However, polioencephalomalacia associated with impaired thiamine metabolism is seen in sheep, and it is attributed to consumption of bracken fern and rock or mulga fern in Australia. Coming to the treatment of bracken fern poisoning. Initial treatment for all species is to discontinue exposure to bracken fern. However, disease can appear weeks after livestock are removed from the fern-infested area. In acutely affected cattle, mortality is usually more than 90%. And one important point to be remembered is the measurement of platelet count is recommended because it is the best prognostic indicator. Then treatment of thiamine deficiency in horses is highly effective if diagnosis is made early. Then injection of thiamine solution at 5 mg per kilogram is suggested, given initially IV every 3 hours, then IM for several days. Oral supplementation may be required for an additional 1 to 2 weeks, although subcutaneous injection can also be done. Then thiamine treatment should also include animals similarly exposed but not yet showing clinical disease, because signs can develop days or weeks after removal from the source of bracken fern. Antibiotics may be useful to prevent secondary infections. Blood or even platelet transfusions may be appropriate but require large volumes, like at least 2 to 4 liter blood, to effectively treat cattle. Though untested, treatment with granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor, which is used to treat aplastic anemia in people, can be considered as a treatment option. And coming to the prevention of bracken fern poisoning. Poisoning, apart from thiamine deficiency, is essentially untreatable. However, it is most easily controlled by preventing exposure. Bracken fern is usually grazed for want of alternative forages. Most commonly, animals are forced to eat bracken fern when other forage is exhausted in late summer. Although some animals may find the bracken fern palatable also. Then poisoning can be avoided by improving pasture management to increase production of alternative forage. It has been suggested that alternating bracken fern contaminated and non-contaminated pastures at 3-week intervals can minimize poisoning. Bracken fern growth can be retarded by close grazing or trampling in alternative grazing pasture systems. Bracken fern density can be reduced by regular cutting of the mature plant, or if the land is suitable, by deep plowing. Herbicide treatment using azulam or glyphosate can be an effective, especially if combined with cutting before treatment. Then let's see the human poisoning with bracken fern. Consumption of milk from cattle with access to bracken increases the risk of human esophageal or gastric cancer. Greater risk to people is direct consumption of bracken fern, because the rhizomes have been used to make flour and the young shoots or crosiers are considered a delicacy in many parts of the world. Tachylocyte has been found as an environmental contaminant in soil and water, and airborne spores present a risk of human exposure. Human exposure through any means should be of concern because tachylocyte is a proven carcinogen. Now let's see the most important points regarding the bracken fern poisoning. All of them are discussed before, but let's see the most important points once again. Bracken fern contains a toxic glycoside called tachylocyte and thiaminase. In cattle, chronic bracken fern ingestion caused by consumption of animals' body weight over several months can result in bone marrow suppression as well as alkylation of DNA leading to tumors. So two conditions, that is bone marrow suppression and neoplasia. The problem will manifest as hemorrhages, hematuria and cancers in bladder or other organs. Bone marrow suppression can lead to anemia and neutropenia. The thiaminase seems to affect horses more than cattle. Horses develop thiamine deficiency, which is manifested as weight loss, ataxia, lethargy, tremors, recumbency, and death. This condition in horses is called bracken staggers. That's all. So if you like the video, like it, and if you have any suggestions, please comment and share the video with your friends. If you have not yet subscribed, please subscribe and click the notification bell. So see you soon with another video. Thank you.